we hardly see them. They don't walk, they run. But I got plenty left, I've set my sight on. Don't wait up, leave the light on. I'll be home soon. I've been left for dead before, but I still fight on. Don't wait up, leave the light on. I'll be home soon.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to the Parlor Room in downtown Northampton for another in our series of 25th anniversary concerts for Signature Sounds. We've got a frosty, cold January evening and a wonderful show for you tonight. Jeffrey Focalt is here. Jeffrey, good evening.
Good evening.
How you doing?
I'm great. It's nice to be here.
It's lovely to see you on a stage.
I feel the same way. It's lovely to be on a stage. And I was setting up and I realized this is one of the last ones I got to play before everything shut down.
Do you remember what the last gig was? The final gig?
The last gig was north of Phoenix, up in the hills in sort of the northern Arizona. I wish I could remember the name of the venue. It was a nature center of some kind. And it was in the middle of a tour that we started in California. It was a trio tour with Eric Haywood playing pedal steel and electric guitar, and Moses playing bass, and I talked to a friend of mine who used to work in the State Department, and she said, go home. So we called the tour. We were supposed to go all the way to West Texas, and we rebooked our flights out of Phoenix the next morning, played the last show. I almost had the name of the Nature Center. Anyway, it was a really sweet show, but it was very strange. You know, everybody knew something was wrong. Some people are coming out, some people are staying home. You know, it was about half full. And but it was sweet in its way, and you know, we just gave the records out rather than rather than exchanging money or shaking hands with anybody. You know, we were like, go ahead, take them.
And who would have guessed, here we are almost a year later, and
it's been a long year.
Unbelievable. Well, you've kept busy, though. You've got a new collection out called Dead Stock Uncollected Recordings, 2005 through 2020.
Yeah, it was something that I actually had on the burner for a few years, and I would just kind of tinker around with it once in a while. I think I made originally it was about 2.5 discs long, and then it got down to about 2 discs. I could have gone all as far back as my first record, but none of that stuff was really interesting to me or particularly original. The stuff that left off the second record was just covers. I did a Bob Dylan cover and a Greg Brown cover, and neither one made it on there. So I just decided to start with 05 and make it sort of an even 15 and try to cut it down to like one thing that you could actually listen to as opposed to a chronological yearbook style.
I was just going to say, I mean, it doesn't hold together like an album of leftovers, like Desperate Pieces. It really sounds like a record, which is...
Well, thank you.
Really nice. And some great songs. You've been holding out.
Well, you know, thank you. I made that album thinking that all I wanted was to not make an album that if you put it on, it felt like a bunch of stuff that didn't matter, right? And I had loved those songs, and I just didn't, for whatever reason, they didn't make it onto the record. The album opens with an old Gary Davis lyric called There's a Destruction on This Land, which we opened every night for, I think, 2 years with the band, playing that song over and over. And I loved the recording, but it was so dark, and it would have weighted the album that it was recorded for into this place where it sort of turned the whole thing, which was already kind of on a knife edge of light dark, just would have been too much, I had to leave it off.
Well, it's great stuff. I imagine we're going to hear some of those selections tonight.
I think so, yeah, at least a couple.
Yeah, let's get to music. Jeffrey Focalt here at the Parlor Room.
Thanks, Jim. This one did make it on there.
All alone in a Mexican joint in Mesa, Arizona. I Maybe out your band on the jukebox, an empty Corona. The sun gone down in the pale thin pecan. No one to talk to, all I can think is your eyes full of train smoke. Your mouth tastes like rain, and I know when I know nothing, I'll always know your name. You're my one and only one. You're my only one. And I'm out here working in the neon light, where the temperature's falling. Hotel coffee, red eye flags, honey, I'm your midnight ringer calling. But the snow comes down from the desert sky, and I tell everybody something, but it's usually goodbye. But not you. You're my one. You're my only one. You're the one I want to talk to. You're the one I know to call. You're the one that's gonna catch me when my pride leads to a fall. The sky full of starlings and axe blades shining in the sun. Oh, you're the angel touched the cold against my lips. You're my only one. Now it's real to real. The country rolls, towns they slide by like ghost repeaters. Faded billboards and big box stores, just like a movie of an empty theater. You look around, you wonder when the seams are going to fail, and how dear is the cost of living here if everything is for sale except you. You're my own. You're my own. Except you. You're my own. You're my own. And I'm all alone in a Mexican joint in Mesa, Arizona. That song in a rented car, a rented Ford truck, actually, because I guess I should say that I finished it. I wrote most of it sitting in a Mexican restaurant in Mesa, Arizona, which is not hard to figure out when you listen to the lyric, but I had a few verses moving around, and I went up to play the Marble Valley Correctional Facility in Rutland, Vermont. It was a pretty sweet gig, you know, set up at the top of the key on the basketball court in the rec room, and play for a bunch of guys who show up on their leisure time break. And I had this, my own truck had thrown the timing chain, and I had to rent a truck to get up there, which was sort of dispiriting. And I got this, they didn't have the car that I rented, and I had this Ford F-150, not the old cool ones, but like the big new one that looks like a tennis shoe. And I it cost all kinds of gas money to get up there and play this prison show for basically no money. And and I was listening to Greg Brown, and I was thinking about that while I was playing the song just now, how much I was just
trying to rip off Greg Brown as hard as I could with the feel of that song. And lo and behold, I did succeed. Here's another one that didn't get onto a record that it was recorded for. It was released on the second Cold Satellite project. But this made it on the Deadstock record.
That light through the trees, that cry in your ears, that's a ferry boat leaving 1 week ago, 4 years. And all my bags were packed, and my ticket was bought. We stayed up all night, we made love. Down we fall, and on some stranger's tongue. Today I heard your name, and it flickered and went out like a careless flame. I still see you in close up, I still feel you all around. Oh, I love your voice, that's a far away sound. You're the shadow slipping sideways, the hum inside of my mind. Every day I wake to forget you. One more time, and on some stranger's tongue. Today I heard your name. It flickered and went out like a careless flame. Oh, it flickered and went out like a careless flame. And it flickered and went out like a careless flame.
I co-wrote that song with Lisa Olstein, who used to live up here and was on the faculty at UMass Amherst, and now she's down in Austin, Texas, on the poetry faculty at UT. Well, let's see here. I have to say it's very exciting to leave my house and do anything. I think everybody feels about the same way, maybe, but I certainly feel like going somewhere is not only a little bit exciting, but it's also sort of perplexing. And though I've done this for 20 years, when I was trying to pack all my stuff up here, it was really hard, and I couldn't remember how it all went. I had to go find a list on my computer and print it out. Mm. Well, I've recently been in touch with my old friend Steve Hayes, Chief, who's in the Iowa Blues Hall of Fame as a drummer, and just a fantastic player. He played on a record that came out on Signature Sounds in 2006 called Ghost Repeater, and we just got back into touch recently, so I'm going to send this one out to him. He was always a match set with Rico Sicalo on the bass. Well, I barely knew him, and he was your friend. I think about it every now and then. I think about the real ones who die with nothing half of the time. And I barely knew him. He's a friend of mine, a friend of mine. Tried to call him once I came through town. I saw him walk in the door, but by the time I got down from the stage, he's gone in the night. I never saw him again, no, I barely knew him. He's your good friend. It's a quick light, slow burn, little wink, a half turn, and gone, gone. A little lie with a broken tooth, and the best liar tells the truth. Truth is gone. Wife and two kids when he died. Every time I hear his name, I only want to cry, cause he could not afford to see the doctor. And then he died, and I barely know him. And I stood when I cried, I barely knew him. Your friend. Think about it, and every now and then I think about all the real ones and how they die. I barely knew. He's a friend of mine, a friend of mine. If that guitar is made entirely of steel, and it is. It's exactly what it's made of. It's a steel guitar, but not like when you see steel guitar in the liner notes of your album, but an actual Telecaster style guitar made of steel in Saginaw, Michigan. It's called a Mule Resophonic guitar, Mule Caster. Is that what it's called? I've been going back and recording a whole bunch of my old back catalog songs, re-recording them acoustic for the last 6 or 8 months. It's been sort of my pandemic project, and then I figure out what else needs to happen and whether I can play it. So sometimes slide guitar or high guitar or octave mandolin or banjo. I got out my banjo, which is a cool instrument that I had spray painted black. And then I've farmed out the strings to my friend Barbara Jean out in Minneapolis, and she's been doing strings. And her partner Mike Lewis, who plays in Bon Iver's band, a beautiful, great bass player and also a great saxophone player. He wrote a string arrangement for one of those tunes, this tune. And now I hear it every time I play it. I'll play it for you. You won't be able to hear the strings, but maybe like a year from now or whenever I get my act together and put that record out. Song's called Cross of Flowers. It's one of my favorite things I ever wrote. I actually never get tired of this song, which is not true of a lot of them. There's a cross of flowers on the roadside where some fool bought it 2 years back. There's an orchard gone to hell beside a burned out one room shack. There's a thousand sparrows falling and a thousand shades of black. I'm coming home. There's a steeple on the skyline, like a single iron nail. There's a windmill doing nothing, and a low moan on the rails, where the coal train takes the corner. Light begins to fade, and I'm coming home. I'm coming home. There's a red barn in the half-light, and there's a white frost in the shade, and in the bars down off the main drag, they're drinking down what they got paid. And I wonder, in all of my leaves, if I ever could have stayed. I'm coming home. I'm coming home. There's a junked out car in the tall grass. It's never gonna sell. Jimmy's raising daughters.
Jack's out raising hell. And I always said I loved you. I never said I loved you. Well, 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 I'm coming home. I'm coming home, coming home.
Well, let's see. I'm gonna do I'll do one more, and then we'll take a break and talk to Jim for a little while. Now, this is a song called Everybody's Famous, and this is on an album called Horse Latitudes that Signature Sounds put out in 2011 or 12, somewhere around there. Everybody's famous. Everybody's free. Everybody's broken heart is shining like a new TV. On the walls of a dark room where the world used to be. Everybody's famous. Everybody's free. There's a fire in the windrow, a wolf out in the corn. There's a wild man waiting for the moment to be reborn. And your life is like a ticket only waiting to be torn. Everybody's famous. Everything is gone. If your tongue is sleeping, curled inside your head, like a lion, like a serpent, you might as well be. If your heart is beating sealed inside your rib, it's upon that dark election the only love that lives. Everybody knows you. They saw your billboard in the rain, and they heard your mama crying when you forgot your own real name. And then she voted for your heartbreak. Then she smiled at your shame. And everybody's famous. They know it's all a game. Everybody's famous. Everybody's famous. Kingdom of heaven is inside of me. Oh, and I wanna kick the lights out, 'cause I know there's something left to be. And everybody's famous. Everybody's free.
Jeffrey Focalt here at the Parlor Room all by himself.
It's all right. This has been the last 9 months, you know. Mostly I sit in my office, so this is a delightful change of pace.
There you go. Well, this whole series of concerts is all about the Signature Sound's 25th anniversary, so I want to take a little walk down memory lane with my somewhat foggy memory.
Mm-hmm.
You joined us in 2004.
Yeah.
And 2004, that period was just an amazing growth spurt for us. We had, in the course of a couple of years, all these great songwriters: Josh Ritter, Laurie McKenna, Chris Delmorse, Dave Carter and Tracy Grammer, Peter Mulvey,
Aaron McCune. Yeah, they're just, it was everybody all over the place.
All over the place. And as often would happen with small labels like us, you know, you get cash strapped, frankly, when you have that first big success, particularly back then when you were counting on, you know, physical, you had to have physical product because there really wasn't digital music yet.
Absolutely, yeah.
So one day, Carrie Bernard, your manager, called me up.
Yes, dear Carrie Bernard, she was so good. I love her.
Yeah. She was just so enthusiastic and sent me Miles from the Lightning and I believe that either the demos or the rough recordings of Stripping Cane.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, at the time I had like 6 maxed out credit cards and like could not take on another artist. No, but it was so great,
oh.
You know, and, you know, Carrie sent me your stuff and I'm like, all right, this guy looks like Kris Kristofferson and writes like Townes Van Zandt. How do we say no to that?
That's beautiful. You know, that finding a home at Signature was a road. You know, we sat on that record for a year before we really did anything with it in terms of printing. And she wanted to make sure that I understood how the music industry worked and... which is, you know, a dismaying version of education when you do learn how it works. And so, you know, we talked to a number of labels that tried to give me, I want to say, 3 times or 4 times as much money as I'd spent to make the record, which was almost, you know, it was obviously sort of out of pocket on my part, and I was driving a truck that cost $250. So, you know, they wanted to lock me into a 3-record deal. I went down to Nashville and had a meeting at a long table with a guy at a label that will remain anonymous. And, you know, he said, how do you see your career progressing? And I said, well, the only thing I care about is, you know, I'd read this book about how it all worked. And I was like, I just want to own my own master recordings, you know, and own my own intellectual property. And he was like, that is great. I'm so glad we could have this meeting. And he got up and left. And the best part was finding a home where, you know, I could exploit the recordings with help, you know, and we both understand how important that is and always has been, and I could also rely on owning my own intellectual property down the line, you know, when the albums would revert. And it was the best possible world. You know, a lot of people get into the music business and they try to build the attic on their house first.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a gamble, right? Like, you gamble that the label makes you famous enough to make your money on the gate. And if it doesn't work, you know, you're locked into a multi-record deal. They're not going to promote you. Nothing's going to happen. And so to find a small label that had all the smarts of a big label and was just applying them with a certain amount of discretion, that made a great impact on my, you know, career, obviously, and also sort of my ideas about how you could do this, which was like, if you just work with people you actually like and respect, you'll be fine. You don't have to go out there and sign your life away.
And here you are.
Yeah.
15, 16 years later.
Right, yeah.
Still out there doing it.
Yeah, still out there. Well, I mean, you know, still thinking about it right now.
Yeah. Well, one thing I wanted to talk about a little bit is you share your home now with not one, but 2 songwriters.
Oh, yeah.
Chris Delmorse, we all know and love, is wonderful, and you guys have made music together, although we're still waiting for the duo album, Jeff.
Yeah, me too. I think we even have like a cover image picked out, but we have to actually record it.
There you go. But also your daughter, Hazel,
yeah,
is a budding songwriter.
Honestly, she's by far the most prolific member of the household. If she goes a day and a half without writing a song, she says she's in a rut and complains about it. you know, and I'll write a song for like 5 years. So I don't have a lot of patience for her rut. But she's, yeah, she writes
at age, what, 13 now?
She's 12.
She's 12.
She started writing songs when she was 11. She had had piano lessons, and it was a really cool version of learning piano. I don't know about you, but I was made to take piano when I was a kid, and I felt like I was being forced to take something that I had some natural interest and facility with, and treat it like math class, right? I'm looking at images on a page with these little notations, and I really, like, my brain didn't admit that stuff at all, and I, you know, this sweet old lady who was very sharp, you know, wrap you on the hands when you screwed up kind of thing, and I just couldn't do it. And she had a version where you play and sing both at the same time from the get-go, and she's just very fluid in terms of her understanding of chordal relationships, keys, all that stuff. You can pretty much, you know, like the other night she was playing a song on the ukulele, and I looked over and Chris was flashing her the chord changes, the number by the Nashville number system with her hand, so she could play along with something that I was playing. So she's got it, you know, it's all in there.
That's got to be amazing for you to watch that whole music discovery.
Yeah. It's
up close once again, and to kind of think back to your journey on it too.
That's a really insightful way to put it, because she's still at the place, you know, when you're in the seventh grade, you don't know what you can do and what you can't do. You don't know that that everybody already wrote all the songs about one thing or another, right? Like you have no sense of cliche at all. So you just, it's all a blank slate, and it's she already has a really full-grown and sophisticated sense of melody and construction, you know. And she doesn't want to listen. When I say, you know, we should really listen to Hank Williams, because he basically wrote the playbook for how we put these songs together. And she's like, doesn't care. You know, no interest in listening to Hank Williams.
She'll get there. She'll get there eventually.
She might come back around.
Well, you sent me a recording before the holidays of a song she wrote that was just fantastic. She's got a beautiful voice. And
yeah. Yeah, it's just, you know, anybody who has raised a child probably comes to the conclusion at some point that they don't bear any responsibility for what's happening unless it's bad, right? So, like, you watch the good things happen, and it doesn't feel like it has anything to do with you. It feels like watching a flower grow up, or, you know, I mean, I guess that sounds sort of twee, but you know what I mean. It just, the best parts feel very much like a gift, you know, like nothing that you earned.
Yeah. Well, that must have been one nice thing about this year is, you know, you're normally gone half the time. You know, being able to be up close and personal for a long period of time like that must be kind of a gift as well.
Yeah. You know, we never, all of us, ate 100 meals together, except, you know, the first year she was around, I think I was only gone for 3.5 weeks, if you added it up. You know, I stayed home, and I think Chris had a song on a TV show or something that sort of floated us for a little while. And yeah, if you are a professional leaver, you just get, you know, your whole family grows up around that dynamic. Chris leaves, so I stay home. I leave, Chris stays home. Hazel, you know, gets to run her game, sort of divide and conquer. And suddenly we're all, you know, just hanging out all the time.
There you go.
It's beautiful.
Yeah. Have you picked up any new hobbies in this time, or any new new skills?
Bad habits.
Bad habits.
New skills. Well, I've been engineering this sort of retrospective thing on my own, which has been interesting to think about the engineering side. Jared's probably laughing behind his mask, but you know, setting up microphones and figuring out how to get sounds with the proper technical aspects taken care of. That's been interesting. I lost a good 10 days earlier up in the month building a stand-up desk out of some 8-quarter slab pine live edge. Putting a desk in the corner of my office, you know.
Well, there you go.
I've always been a bad carpenter, so that's actually not new. But it was fun to get to indulge the interest.
There you go. Jeffrey Foucault's with us today at the Parlor Room. Before we get back to music, just wanted to mention you have been kind enough to not only do this show tonight, but you've got another one coming up. It's not a show necessarily, but one of our backstage sessions coming up.
Yeah, when I learned about the backstage sessions, I thought it sounded so interesting, and it also immediately made me feel like, who would I like to talk to for an hour and just ask them all the questions? One of the best parts about being a musician on the road, especially on our sort of level of that experience, is, you know, you end up meeting most of the people who influenced you down the line somewhere, right? Like, I opened for, I would say, 3/4 of the people that I listened to when I was a youngster, I ended up meeting them sometime down the line and had, you know, one or another experience with them. If it was Chris Smither, who's on the wall over here, you know, we did about 60 shows together, I think, in 04, wow. 05, in there, all around the world, and I learned a ton from him. And I opened a bunch of shows for Greg as a youngster, and I've always wanted to be able to ask him some questions, and I thought this would be a great opportunity.
Well, especially since it seems to me anyway, he's basically retired, right? I mean, he at least from touring.
Yeah, I mean, I guess we all are right now, but he had said that he was pretty much done. My buddy Eric Koskinen and I were on the road in Iowa not this past spring, but the spring prior, and he and Bo, Greg and Bo, played the Cedar Cultural Center in Minneapolis, and we went to the show. And beforehand, earlier in the week, we went out. We were playing Iowa, so we stopped in Iowa City and went to this Mexican restaurant and got tacos with Greg and Bo, which was a great sit down. You know, the four of us in the booth just kind of talk about the music business or talk about whatever's going on. And yeah, he said he was pretty much hanging it up and didn't expect to play more. So he timed it pretty well.
Yeah.
You know, he said he would do benefits and he would do
some local stuff and that kind of thing.
Yeah, Seed Savers. You know, there's a lot of people that I think that depend on him to help support their causes. And, you know, God bless him, he does that stuff. So
it's one of the saddest things about this pandemic is we're going to have seen the last of some certain performers. Chris Christopherson just the other day came out and said, you know, I'm retired, I'm done.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, no,
off
I
the
think...
road forever, you know?
It's definitely going to sort of... I don't want to sound flip about it, you know, but it's going to call pretty hard the numbers of people that can be out on the road. And honestly, we should all stop and think about how much we need to be out and how we need to be out and how much jet fuel we burn and all the assumptions that we make about what modern life ought to look like. You know, this was a good time for everybody to stop and think about it. So that'll be a good thing to ask
Greg
about.
Definitely a reset. Yeah, it's definitely a reset.
So I think the Greg interview is on the 14th of March, here on the Signature Sounds.
Yep, Sunday night.
Website, yeah. Right before the Grammys. You know, so we have time to go accept the Grammys.
Yeah, there you go. Wear your tux. Jeffrey Foucault.
Yeah, thanks, Jim.
Here at the Parlor Room.
Well, what do I want to... Problem is I write stuff down and then I disagree. Talker, I called, I woke you up, and I wondered who I thought I was when I knew you for a little while. Did I know you? Is that just your style?
deep water. You're like a river underground. You speak thunder. You never make a sound. There's one note, if you can play it. There's one word, if you can say it. There's one prayer, if you can pray it. Each one is the same. Now you scarecrow, you got your collar turned up cool. Keep on rocking, I'm right behind you. There's one note, if you can play it. There's one word, if you can say it. There's one prayer, if you can pray it. Each word is the same.
That's the song I wrote for Bo Ramsey. This one. This is the title cut from the most recent solo album I made, not the retrospective, the Dead Stock record, but the Blood Brothers record. This is a song I wrote with my friend Billy Conway about his life.
If I saw you, would you know my name? If I saw you, would you know my name? I used to know you, I used to be your man. Back in the traveling time, Blood Brothers, back when you were mine. Do you remember, honey, I was your Valentine? To stay, hold on to what we had. How could I know I would live through my life haunted by your sad smile? Sometimes I hold you in my dreams at night, but I never told you, honey, it never seemed right. I'll meet you somewhere on the other side. If I saw you, would you know my name? If I saw you, would you know my name? If I saw you, if I saw you,
Speaking of Hazel, last night, we went down the rabbit hole looking at videos from MTV in the 80s and the 90s that I remembered and had some sort of impression on me as a youngster with cable in those years. And she was so nonplussed, but she was excited when we put on Billy's band, Treat Her Right, which is sort of the precursor in some ways to Morphine, the same lead singer, Mark Sandman. And then she saw Billy in his 20s rocking away on the drums on I Think She Likes Me, which is just such a great song, man. But took her a second to realize that it was Billy, who, you know, we toured together so much the last 10 years, and Billy, you know, not only got to watch Hazel grow up, but also, you know, spent, because he was an early riser and maybe the only one in the band most of the time, he spent a lot of pre-dawn hours talking about Barbies and stuff, Barbies and horses, with Hazel. Let's do another one from the Deadstock record. This is a song called Crown of Smoke. She's married to the ladies at the bar. She's married to the bar and to the ladies who say, are you all right here, huh? Is everything all right here, huh? Like it's a drink they're asking after, not the man who's talking at her. If she wants the whiskey in her mouth and writes a letter, and wants a cigarette, she gave up on love somewhere along the way. Along the way, somewhere she gave up on love. She gave up on other things, on babies and wedding rings. And now she crossed room like the dancer she was, and she drifts through the cocktail crowd
playing grown ups with a dollar in her hand for the internet jukebox she hates and plays every time she plays Desperado. Sometime around closing, she steps outside. She steps outside sometime around closing. She looks up at the city sky. The strange light as the clouds push by. And in the stillness, wears a pale crown of smoke. Alone on the street in a thrift store coat with the words to the song still running through her mind. Her feet aren't cold and it's winter time. She's married to the ladies at the bar. Married to the bar and to the ladies who say, are you all right here, hon? Is everything all right here, hon?
Crown of Smoke is the name of that one. Well, sometimes I write happy songs and then I never do anything with them. Sometimes I write funny songs. I wrote a funny one time about people from Illinois. I grew up in Wisconsin, and people from Illinois tend to drive too fast and own lake houses and motorboats and jet skis. And that's not the sort of thing that ever gets onto a record for me. I don't know why. I tried to fix it. And I wrote this song with just a bunch of references to driving up and down the I-5 in California. On tour, this was probably like, 15 years ago. And I recently had my friend Van Dyke Parks write a 9-piece string arrangement for this song. It's going to come out as a single, I guess, sometime this year.
Jog around her, dreaming into gold. Little Samba on the rail. Ocean silver rolling slow. Cup of coffee, Clementine, cigarette, taste so fine. One on one, friend of mine. If you were here, you'd be gone. If I was singing, you'd sing along. Jacaranda, dreaming in the gold. Pull your dress on, the morning is cold. California, don't let me go. California, don't let me go. California, don't let me go.
Song for a winter day in New England. All right, well, I'm gonna play one more, and thanks everybody for tuning in. Thanks to Signature Sounds and Jim and Jared in Georgia, and everybody who's making this work tonight. What do you think here? I did the thing I used to do routinely, which was to ask for requests and then not play them. So I'll do at least one. Swap guitars. I'll just go ahead and play it on this one. This is a song by one of my heroes, the late great Reiner Patacek. Tachek, I'm never sure how to say it. It's like my name, it's a weird one. Reiner was a slide guitar player who lived in Tucson. He was born in West Germany, and his parents emigrated. Sorry, he was born in East Germany, behind the wall. His parents got out, and he was raised in Chicago, and then he moved to the desert southwest, and he became sort of the godfather of desert rock. He started a band called Giant Sandworms. It became Giant Sand with Hal Gelb. John Convertino and Joey Burns from Calexico, when they split up, that became Calexico, and Giant Sand went its own way. But Reiner was where it all took off, and Reiner died in the 90s. I haven't done this song for a while, and let's see if I can. We'll send this one out to my friend Chris Dombrowski and Robert Stubblefield and Deb Erling out in Missoula.
Taught me without really teaching about this world now. It's not like it was then, and it even rained more often. I remember the fire now and Mama's bright dress and the look on your face when she left. Oh. How did we ever survive with so much missing? It never came back, it just stayed missing. I feel I'm growing radar, receiving messages from out in the plain, the plains of Kansas. Someone, somewhere, someplace out there. As good as I felt lately. Oh, Lily, I love you. Don't know how I ever got by. Well, how you, someone, somewhere, someplace,
everybody.